will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. You are my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. For you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm.
Yeah.
that the Lord is good. Yes, the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Yes, the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Yes, the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Yes, the Lord is good. And His goodness endures forever. Yes, His goodness endures forever. Yes, His goodness endures forever. Yes, Your goodness endures forever. When Your mercy endures forever. Lord, Your mercy endures forever. Goodness endures forever. Lord, Your goodness endures forever. Oh, and Your mercies endure forever. Oh, Lord, Your mercy endures forever. Oh, yes, Your mercies endure forever. Your mercies endure forever. your goodness endures forever. When your mercies endure forever. Your mercies endure forever. joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, love, abundant life. Joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, love, abundance of life. Joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, love, love. By the Holy Ghost, joy, 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 fullness of joy. Joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, love, abundance of love. Joy, 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 abundance of joy, love, love, love. Like rivers flowing out, like rivers flowing out. Oh, it's joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, love, abundant love. Joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, 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 abundance of God, kind of Lord, the love of the Lord, the love of the Almighty. Joy, 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 fullness of joy, love, 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 abundant love. Joy, 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 fullness of joy. Signs and wonders, your miracles. 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 Signs and wonders, your miracle. 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 Signs and wonders, your miracles. Signs and wonders, your miracles. Signs and wonders, your miracles. Signs and wonders here, Lord. Here today, Lord. Here today, Lord. For we believe, Lord. We believe every word you said, every word you spoken, Lord. We believe, we receive, we believe, we receive, we believe, we receive. Our hearts are open wide to you, Lord. Our hearts are open wide to you, Lord. Our hearts lay bare before you, Lord. Our hearts wide open to you, Lord. No other thing we desire, no other thing we desire but you, Lord. Come reign, Lord, over us. We give you full control. Reign over us. Right. your signs and wonders, your miracles, signs and wonders, your miracles, signs and wonders, your miracles, signs and wonders. Your
miracles, signs and wonders. Miracles, signs and wonders. Your miracles, signs and wonders.
This day belongs to you, and we belong to you, Lord. We are yours, Father. For whatever you would have us do, we do. Wherever you would have us go, we go. Whatever you would have us say, we say. We declare it by your Spirit, Lord. By your Spirit. Your signs and wonders. Your signs and wonders. Confirming your word. Confirming your word with signs and wonders. Your signs and wonders.
Living and moving and dwelling in you. Yes, I'm living and moving and dwelling.
you've been our dwelling place, Lord, in every generation. No surer dwelling place, no place I'd rather be than in your courts and in your presence. Oh, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord, rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God, than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Oh, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. And how much more you've given us, Lord. How much more you've given us, Father. Oh, you prepared a place for us. You prepared a place for us to dwell. That's why I'm living and moving and dwelling in you. Yes, I'm
living and moving and dwelling in you.
Yes, I'm
living and moving and dwelling in you.
Yes, I'm
living and moving and dwelling in you.
Under the shadow of your wings, oh, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings, Lord, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings, Lord, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings, Lord, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings, Lord, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings, Lord, under the shadow of your wings, Lord, I will abide. Under the shadow of your wings.
Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Let's worship him. Father, I ask you to baptize your saints again with the fresh fire of the Holy Ghost this morning. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, a fresh touch of heaven till we're moving over in the realms of glory. Father, help us to walk into this place, Father, exploding in the realms of your presence, in the realms of your glory, moving and listening and doing what the Holy Ghost is doing, Father. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your presence, Father. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Father. Because you are so good. You are so good, God. You are so good. You're so good, Father. You're so good, Lord Jesus. We worship you. We praise you. Father, we thank you for your glory, the glory of your presence. His presence is here to meet every need of every person in this place. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your goodness. Father, Jende. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Zekata. We thank you, Father God. Oh, glory. We thank you, Lord, that Jesus is in the midst of his church. Jesus is right here where two or three are gathered in his name. There he said he would be right here, right here. So Jesus is here. Jesus is here. Where two or three are gathered together, there he is right in the middle of what's going on, wanting and desiring for you to reach out and touch him with the realms of his glory pouring out. The realms of his glory pouring out, just waiting on you to touch him. Just touch heaven. Touch heaven and earth will grow strangely dim. Touch heaven and earth won't mean so much. Touch heaven and your problems will dissipate. Touch heaven and you'll be co-laboring with Jesus Christ the righteous. Hallelujah. Touch heaven and he will show forth his glory through you. It won't be you doing anything. You just touch heaven and you say, here I am, Lord, like Isaiah said. Here I am, send me. Send me, use me, God. Yes, Sopa. Because Isaiah was already so in love with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And when he saw that there was a need, because he was already captivated with his presence, when he saw that there was a need and there was a lack, he said, here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord, send me. But he didn't think he had the ability because he said, I'm a sinful man. But when Father sent the angel with the hot coals and touched his lips, he was cleansed. Oh, thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus Christ that washes away all of our sins, that cleanses us from all iniquity. And then you threw your mantle as you ascended up on high. You threw your mantle down upon us by the power of the Holy Ghost when you sent the Holy Ghost so we could do all things that you did, everything, and greater works than what you did. We could do these works, the works that Jesus did, and greater. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is Father's plan and his purpose for us. Is just us allowing him to show forth his mighty power on the inside of us, show forth his glory on the inside of us. Hallelujah. It's nothing of ourselves. His great love that he has for us, it's just so absolutely amazing how much he loves us. If we would just get everyone captivated by the love of God and let his love consume us, we would find ourselves living in a different state. And I'm not talking about the state of California. I'm talking about the state of our spiritual walk. Instead of walking in the earthly realm, we would be walking in the heavenly realms continually. Oh, thank you, Jesus. If we could get captivated by that love, if we would just be captivated, if we would just let him captivate us. The goodness. I just think about how God gave Adam and Eve everything there was to give them. He blessed them. He gave them the most beautiful garden that ever could be imagined. I don't think that we could copy it if we ever tried with everything that man knows, because Father created that Garden of Eden. Because Father did it, and he is so beyond whatever man can even think of. We could only do it by the Spirit. Seeing it in the heavenlies, in the realms of his spirit. But he gave man everything, and he just put one tree. And he says, everything in this garden is yours. You take and you enjoy it. You go out into the earth and you subdue it. You rule it. You are the one that takes authority over everything. I've given all of this to you. All of this to you. Just one thing. Don't touch this tree. Just this one. And probably if they would have spent years and years trying to partake of everything that was in that garden, they would not get through it. But then they're allured over to this one one tree, just one tree. They're allured over to it. When all of heaven's over here, all the glory, all the pleasure, everything that God desired for man to have. I mean, it's amazing he would come down in the cool of the evening and walk with them and visit them. And it didn't take very long. And here they are looking over here at the tree that God told them not to touch. Why'd he tell us not to touch this one? You know, allured over there, and Satan's right there, ready to go, ready to bring the deception, ready to speak his stinking lies and begin to work with the natural mind of man and the thinking of man. See, he deceived one-third of the angels. One-third of the angels in heaven, innumerable amount of angels he deceived. Because he first took deception in, because he wanted to ascend above God. He wanted to take over. And so as soon as he opened himself up to that disobedience, he brought forth more disobedience, and he wanted to take as many as he could in heaven with him. So he went around deceiving. And so that, you know, the enemy was just right there, ready to pounce on that. Looking at what God said, just don't eat of this. You know, if they would have never gone over there and looked at it, if they would have kept that tree far from them, I believe that tree wasn't close to the rest of the stuff. It was set out way over there for them to stay away from. And they didn't have to go near it. If they would have just kept it far from them, if they never stood before it, if they never looked at it, then they would have never touched it. Then they would have never grabbed it. And then they would have never ate of it. They would have never allowed Satan to deceive them because they just didn't go out over there. They didn't go near it. They separated themselves. If they would have separated themselves from it. Isn't that what he's called us to do? Come out from among them, says the Lord. Be ye separate. Be ye separate. See, that's what the blood of Jesus Christ does. He comes and he washes us and he cleanses and he separates us from everything that's in the world. He separates us from the powers of darkness. He gave us complete dominion over the devil. As soon as we receive the blood of Jesus Christ, we have dominion and power and authority over every work of the devil. Every single work of the devil, we have complete dominion and power and authority over it. He destroyed. Is this what the Word of God says? We can go over there and we can look at it and we can read it. Maybe we will in just a minute. But he destroyed the works of the devil. He completely destroyed them so Satan could no longer have any power over you. Never again have power over you. And it's so simple. Don't walk outside of this love and this glory and this goodness and this presence that he's given us. Don't walk outside of what he's done. Don't go over here and look at it. Separate, he says, come out. And then I'll be a father unto you and you shall be my children. And then I will be a father unto you and you shall be my children. Come out from among them, where I can lead you and I can guide you. It's the same as the tree. We want to look at Adam and Eve and we want to go, how could have they done that? The goodness and the love of God, and I mean, it was he that created them, and why couldn't they just be obedient? Why did they have to go over there? Why do we have to go over there? That's right. Why does God's church have to go over there? Why is God's people that know his love and his goodness and his mercy, that he reached down in his goodness and his kindness and his love, and he brought us back to fellowship with him? Oh, he didn't have to do that. He could have just said, done, Adam and Eve. But no, immediately as he dealt with them and their disobedience and their rebellion against him, immediately he said, I will bring forth the Redeemer because I love you. Because I love you, I will bring forth this Redeemer. And from the moment that Adam and Eve disobeyed, God spoke again and again through his prophets about the Redeemer that he would bring, about the redemption he would bring that would wash us and cleanse us and make us pure and holy. And no longer would Satan have power over us. No longer could he hold us captive. No longer would we be bound. No longer, because of his love. Because he loved us so much that he didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but he came that he might bring them back to fellowship and relationship and communion with him, to live over in the realms of his glory, to live over in the realms of his joy and his happiness and his praise in the midst of a wicked and crooked world. He loved us so much that he sent his only begotten son, his only son, to redeem us and bring us back into that fellowship and that glory, that we can live in this world, but it can't touch us. It can't touch us inside. It can't take our joy. It can't take our peace. It can't take our fulfillment. When our fulfillment and our hope is in him, there is nothing around you that can move that. When you're struggling and you're having problems with your life and the circumstances of your world, you haven't let Jesus captivate you today. You haven't let his love overwhelm you. You haven't let his glory captivate you. You've got a lure over here, and you're looking. You're looking. And then when you get to looking, you'll find yourself touching. And if you stay in that realm too long, if you don't run back over here to his presence, because I tell you, he's so good, the grieving power will come on you, and the Lord will do everything he can to prevent you from going over there. If you haven't, you know, got to a place that you've allowed yourself to be deceived, and you've become callous to that gentle touch of the Holy Ghost, if you stay too long, you're going to eat. But if you run back over here to his presence when he convicts you and he says, no, come over here. I tell you what, if you'll stay in his presence in the first place, if you'll pray, and I mean, you know, Jesus said to Peter, he said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. What were they doing? He wasn't talking about a wicked nature. Because that wicked nature is gone. The circumcision of the heart. He came and he circumcised our heart, and he wrote his laws upon our heart. He put them in, and he wrote them upon our minds. He put them in us. He wasn't talking about the sinful nature. He was talking about, you're going to have to tell this body what to do. Because what were they doing? They were sleeping. They went to sleep. He said, watch with me and pray. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. If you'll get over here in the realms of the Holy Ghost, stay over here in the realms of the Holy Ghost, stay over here in the realms of his presence, and you'll have dominion over the flesh, over this body that wants to dictate exhaustion or tiredness or hunger or, you know, just the natural things that the body has. Stay over here in the realms of his glory. Stay over here and enjoy his presence. Let the living waters flow in you. I tell you, why do we want to do anything else but partake of his glory and his love and his goodness and his kindness? Because he's so good. The goodness of God leads men to repentance. The goodness of God. He lets his sun shine on the just and the unjust. He's drawing every man. He's continue pleading with man continually. Come to me, come to me. We come to him and we disobey and we walk away. But oh, thank you, Jesus, if a man sins, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. But Father's continually saying, don't go there, don't touch that, don't do that. I have better things for you. We don't want to spend a lifetime. We don't want to spend a lifetime getting it right there. We want to spend a lifetime showing forth his glory, letting his light shine through us. We want to spend a lifetime over in the realms of his presence. Hallelujah. And if we would just be captivated by him. And it's very simple. When you stay in his presence and in his word and in prayer and in fellowship with him, you will not listen to the deception of the enemy that's continually right there in that natural realm. It's in the natural realm. Think about it. Satan deceived the angels that were in the presence of God. They were up in heaven in the presence of God. They had never known of good and evil. They had never known of deception. They had never partaken of anything but his glory. And Satan's whispering lies drew a third of the angels. And Satan's whispering lies are taking multitudes to hell every moment of every day. People around the world are dying from every age from the conception in the womb till whatever age is the oldest person that's ever lived, people are dying every day, every age. And we do not know the time that is given us on this earth. We do not know. We need to learn to number our days. We need to learn to count our days and our time because we do not know. It's become very real to me recently about how quickly someone can be here and then gone. Like I talked to my dear friend John, Pastor Mark's closest friend since he was a teenager. I talked to him on New Year's Eve. And late Saturday night and early in the morning, Sunday morning, 2 days later, he slipped over into the realms of glory. He had so many plans to knock things up, hit the devil in the head. This year, he had so many plans of seeing people saved and brought into the kingdom of God. You know, and that's what he was sharing with me on New Year's Eve. What God was doing and what God was going to do. And I love to talk to John. John, I was so close to John because he was always talking about the kingdom. He was always talking about Jesus. And you know, I thought about that, you know, when John passed, I said, you know, the only thing that people want to hear is Jesus. I really don't have anything to offer. Never thought I had much anyway. But at the same time, what drew me to John? I didn't really have a relationship to John before he got saved, with John. It was after he got saved. He used to come to my house all the time and we'd fellowship on the things of the kingdom. And, you know, I never knew when John was going to drop in. He'd just drop in and then we'd fellowship on the things of the kingdom. Because he fell so in love with Jesus and he was so hungry for God. And, you know, he knew I was my mom and dad's daughter, and I must know more than what he knew. So he'd come in and we would just talk about Jesus. But that's what people want. They want to see a people that have a light, that have a hope, that have the glory of God living in them, not those that are in despair. Because the only reason that you would be in despair is because you got outside of this glory and outside of this love relationship with Jesus. Because you won't do anything in God outside of this love. You know, with John, you couldn't be around him more than a few minutes without him going, I love you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Because he really loved Jesus. And then he, you know, when he went up, he was so captivated, so captivated. But I tell you, you don't know when God's going to call you home. Be so in love with him. And why not when he's so good? Why would we do anything else? Because he has been so good to us. Now let me ask you, what has the devil done to bless you?
Nothing.
Why in the world would you want to be part of God's enemy? Why in the world would you want to be allured over into the things of the world? Why? Why? But we allow it. Anything that would steal your confidence in God, anything that would steal your confidence in God is the devil hissing at you. Because, you know, the simple thing is, it doesn't matter what the world tries to do to us and what people say and what our circumstances are and what comes our way. We're more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. We're more than a conqueror. Those things can't touch us because of our relationship with him. Now, if we get so busy, because we can get so busy about God's work even too. I did it. I've done it. I looked and I said, I see all of these people that have gotten so busy doing God's work that they're outside of relationship and their kids are going to hell in a handbasket. I'm like, I'm never going to do that. I'm never going to do that. I'm never going to do that. And then I got in the ministry and I'd be up to 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, just going after it and just all these things that needed to be done. And then thank God physically, I couldn't go anymore. I couldn't move anymore. And I found out, you know what? It'd all be fine without me. And I could seek the Lord. And not be so caught up in all the stuff that I thought needed to be done. Because we can get allured with busy in the kingdom. And then bring ourselves to complete and total exhaustion physically, mentally, spiritually, and in every way, and we have nothing else to give because we were given of ourselves because we were so busy. We weren't over here captivated in the realms of His presence, in the realms of His glory. So He was moving through us. So His glory was being revealed through us. If you guys want to, you can sit down, or you can stand up with me. I guess everybody's just captivated by the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Father. Oh, God, you're so good. That is my prayer, that we, everyone, be so captivated, and the convicting, convincing power of the Holy Ghost be so strong that it convicts every one of us of our sin. It convicts every person in this place of their sin and shows how exceedingly sinful sin is to God. How God hates and He despises everything to do with it. He won't look upon it. He turned from His Son when He was on the cross and He was being that ultimate sacrifice to bring us back. He turned and He would not look upon His Son when His Son took upon the sins of the world, because God won't even look on it. God only will fellowship in the realms of His glory and the realms of His love and His goodness and His kindness and His mercy. He will only fellowship in His goodness. He will only fellowship in those things that are good and righteous and holy. He won't look upon them. If we won't look upon them, people, if we won't go over to that tree, then we'll never touch it. That's why He says, come out from among them and be separate. Because He's making it clear what He has done. He's making it clear that He has done this complete separation. So if we won't go there, it will take everything that would cause us to be distracted in the first place. Because it starts out with the little bitty things. It starts out with the little bitty distractions. And if we'll take it, if we can't handle it, if we can't handle those things, and we can't keep the television off, and we can't shut down the computer, and we can't turn our phones off, if we'll take it all and we'll just dump it in a pile like they did when all the people got saved in the book of Acts, and they brought all of their crafts, all of the things that had them bound by Satan, and they burned them. And it was millions of dollars back then. And they took them all and they burned them. They didn't sell them and get some money out of them. They took them and they said, it's an end. It's an end. They brought them and they burned them. They said, we're done. We're done with that deception and that lie that has taken so many to hell. We're done. And they burnt it all. And they turned around from everything that they had followed before. And they began to follow Jesus. And didn't look back. They left it in a pile of ashes. There's nothing to go back to when you leave it in a pile of ashes. When it costs you something. If we'll just put it away, if we'll just get rid of it, get done with it. If it distracts you, if it causes you to go over into the realms of touching that tree and being disobedient to God, get rid of it. It's not worth hell. Jesus could come at any moment. The rapture of the church could happen at any moment. You don't know when. You could fall dead at any moment. Hell's not worth it, people. It was created for the devil and his angels. The blood of Jesus Christ was created for mankind to come to Him. And the fellowship restored. And the relationship restored. But you know why I think it's so important, and the Holy Ghost says it's so important to teach on this, is because the church has come over to the tree and said it's okay. We can eat of it because the blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed us from all sins, and we can have whatever we want to have and do whatever we want to do, and we'll be right with God because He cleansed us from our sins. They've taken the word of God and they've twisted it, and they've made it a lie, and it's another gospel. They can say Jesus all they want to, but they're not preaching Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. They've gone over to another Jesus. You know, Paul warned him. He said, look, for 3 years I have warned you night and day that when I depart, those wicked men are going to come in. And even among yourselves, they will raise up. Even among yourselves, they'll raise up. You know, when we see Father deal with it in Revelation chapter 2, when He says, you allow that woman Jezebel to teach in the church. You allow these things in the church. You allow them. You deal with it. God deals with it. His people deal with it. When we see it, we're like King David and we say, I'm the man. And we fall upon our face and we repent. Because nobody is above deception. No one is above it. If you go over there and you start looking, come out from among them, be ye separate, says the Lord. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For he that loves the world has not the love of the Father in them. If you're caught up in the world, if you've let it taint you, I tell you what, you're whiter than snow. But then the world, if you're looking at it and you're partaking of it, it's tainting you with the blackness and the darkness. And you can't have two masters. You'll either have one or the other. You'll hold to one or the other. You can't serve two. You cannot serve two. It will either be God or it will be the powers of darkness. And I tell you what, money is a big key. What we have to be able to live out this natural life. He simply said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You will have no need of all of these things. I'll provide whatever you need. Yes, granted, a lot of us haven't stepped in to that place where we press in for that provision that we need. But at the same time, he said he would do it if we'd step into all of these glorious things that he has in the realms of heaven for us to partake of. But if we're going to seek our own life, we're going to lose it. It's his promise. If we lose our life in this world and we realize that we're bought with a price, that we are not our own, we do not belong to ourselves. Say, I'm bought with a price.
I'm bought with a price.
If you're bought with a price, say it again.
I'm bought with a price.
I am not my own.
I don't belong to me anymore.
Jesus paid your debt. He paid your debt. So you don't have to be bound any longer by the powers of darkness. You don't have to be deceived. But I'm telling you what, Satan knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing, people. That's why we have to stay over in the Holy Ghost. He knows what he's doing. You think he deceived one third of the angels. You need to really think about that. You need to take that in. He deceived one third of the angels. But we think, but you know, I can do this. And then, you know, and this is what people do. Oh, well, I'm going to go ahead and do this and enjoy it a little bit. And God forgive me. That heart's going to become hard and callous. And the only thing for you to do when all of a sudden the Holy Spirit gets through to your ears and he hits your heart, that little bit of conviction come again, fall on your face before God. Because the enemy will suck the life out of you all the way to the flames of hell. Because Father, one day we'll have to look at you and tell you to depart, you workers of iniquity. He paid the way. He gave it all to us. But he'll have to tell you to depart if you don't receive what he's done. If you want to come your own way, with your own thinking, with your own ability, try it out if you want to. Cain did, and it didn't get him anywhere but cursed. And God pleaded with Cain. He said, Cain, why are you upset? You know, if you bring the right sacrifice, the one I've called for, because without the blood, there is no remission of sins. There has to be that right sacrifice of blood. Yes. And if that sacrifice of an animal's blood would have been enough, there would have been no more conscience of sin. See, the blood of Jesus Christ came to give us no more conscience of sin. He gave us, he imparted to us the divine nature so we would have no more conscience of sin. That's what's done in us. But then the world allures us. And we try to figure it out like Cain did. And we try to put it all together. Why can't I touch this and have some of this? That preacher does and this person does and that. And you begin to get your eyes on people. Instead of on the Word of God. And instead of on Jesus. And you look and you do what people do. And you justify it because somebody else does. And the Lord's convicting you. But you justify until there's that callousness there. I don't care what people do. Do you want to go to hell with them?
No.
Do you want to spend eternity in hell?
No.
By looking at what people do? Or do you want to look into this perfect law of liberty?
Yeah.
And say, you know what? I believe God means what he says right here.
light that's shining in me is drawing me over here. That light of the gospel of the blood of Jesus Christ that cleansed me from all sin is shining in me. And he's saying, this is my word and this is the truth. Come. Come to me. Come to me. If we'll partake of it and believe it, he'll live it out in us. Isn't that amazing? That is amazing. All we have to do is say, here I am, Father, I'm staying over here in you. Well, the tree's over there. Here I am, Father, I'm staying over here in you. I'm staying over here in you, Lord. And then we'll be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day. He is the keeping power. He will keep us. He will keep us. As I was saying Wednesday night, he so laid it out so clearly. Just right in the Psalms, Psalms 23. His rod and his staff, they do comfort me. Because he'll be grabbing you with that hook. The Lord is my shepherd. Ha ha. I shall not want. There will be no lack. There'll be no lack. There'll be no lack. I shall not want or desire anything else because he's enough. When you get to figuring it out on yourself and you get all miserable, it's because you're figuring it out on yourself for yourself. And you get all miserable about all your stuff. You're saying God's not good enough. Is that sad? Yes. See, that's why God got so angry with the children of Israel when they murmured and they complained, because they were saying, God, you are not sufficient. You're not enough. We've got the glory cloud going before us in the daytime, and we got the fire of your presence at night, but you're not enough. And God said, I hear you. I hear what you spoke. I heard the words you said. And God got angry. And thank God for a Moses that stood in the gap. Oh, thank you, Jesus, that we can be repairers. We can be those that stand in the gap, and we can be those that repair the breach, and we can be those that restore the past to dwell in. And we can get a hold of people, and we can yank them back over here in the spirit. It may not be a lot of what you got to say, but it's a lot of you being on your knees saying, Father, you see and you know, and I cry out to you, God, because I see the reality of eternity every moment. We have to live in the reality of eternity. We must live in the reality of eternity. We cannot allow the enemy to desensitize us and cause us to grow distant from that reality, that our existence could be gone in the next moment. And only those things that we had in Jesus Christ will last. Only that relationship and that fellowship in him will last. Nothing else. There'll be nothing else. We'll stand before him. When we stand before him, if you were to stand before him in the next couple of hours, if God was to call you in the next couple of hours, if your time was to end in the next couple of days, what would you have to bring the king? We can have so much to bring the king, but because continually we have audience with the king every day. Every day we have audience, and he's just saying, come over here into my presence, and I will lift you up. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And you know, people try to figure it out to bring it down to the natural realm, but you can't figure it out. All you can do is say, this is what the word says, and so I'm going to participate. And then when you participate, when you taste and see how good he is, then you go, oh, oh. But you have to keep yourself, because remember, Satan deceived 1/3 of the angels that were before the presence of the Almighty God. He deceived Adam and Eve, and he's deceiving men on this earth continually every day, and a lot of them stand behind a pulpit saying that they're declaring the word of God and they're leading men astray. Nothing's changed from the Old Testament. In that, the blind prophets stand behind the podium every day. And a lot of them, you know, I know of preachers that have gotten so messed up, their life a total wreck. And then, you know, some of them's got turned around. Some of them's died in their sins because they wouldn't turn around. You know, I know preachers that God used mightily, and they got so messed up, and God convicted them to bring them back, and convicted them to bring them back, and they would come back and repent, and they'd get back over the mess, and they'd get back over the mess, and they'd get back over the mess. And finally, right in the middle of the mess, they die. Right in the middle of it. Right in the middle of the bed of adultery. They die instantly. And it's over for them. But then I know preachers that, you know, they've been in all the mess, and then they don't, they've spent so much time making their money in the pulpit that they don't know what else to do. And so that's the only place they can make money. So, you know, instead of just staying over here in repentance and trusting God, they use a platform to impart. Because when there is a wicked person speaking, he's imparting. You don't want to sit under it. Don't go to a church where there's a person that's caught up in all kinds of ungodliness and wickedness and proclaiming it from the pulpit and saying it's okay. Now in the 21st century, it's okay that you do that. Don't go there, because then it will be imparted to you. I've gone to many services where people were praying for people, and I didn't see the Holy Ghost. I saw deception. I saw the powers of darkness. I wasn't about to let those people pray for me and touch me. They were not imparting their mess to me. Because I did it a couple of times, and then I would go home and I'd have the most hideous dreams of all the wickedness that was going on in their life. And I'm like, oh, Jesus, break this thing. Lord, forgive me for letting them impart their mess to me. Be careful who you let lay hands on you. I tell you, it's just amazing. It's amazing how God's people just drink up what people are saying because they're on TV. If they're on TV, probably just don't even watch them. Usually the men and women of God are in little bitty churches because they haven't got caught up in the fame. They haven't got caught up in the pride. They haven't got caught up in the, I got to do all of this now because I've got all of this load on my shoulders and I've got to carry all of this for the kingdom. You want to be careful what you hear and what you do. People suck in the music because it says Jesus in it. Well, my goodness gracious, I see church people sucking the music and it don't have Jesus on it. And I'm like, what is that? That was birth. See, Satan was the worshiper in heaven. And he knows how to bring the deception right in the worship so it will be imparted and grafted into you. And he'll put Jesus in it too. But does it have the anointing from heaven, or does it have an anointing from hell? See, I see anointings on people. And some of them, you know, and I'm not talking about in this place, but, you know, you'll see, you know, several years ago, watching who was going to be the president, I said there's anointing on that person, but it's an antichrist anointing. It's a turning the hearts of the people in our nation away from God. And it's so deceiving. We just got to, you know, love everybody and accept everybody, you know, because God is love, and we got to just accept everybody. Are we light or are we darkness? If we're light, Ephesians chapter 5 clearly goes through it. The love of God reproves the darkness. You don't sit by darkness and not reprove it. The love of God, and it's not your ability to reprove it. It may be on your knees, seeing that heart and that callousness of that heart broken so you can speak by the Spirit. See, so many people in that, you know, and you want to be careful looking at that, because people get out there and they're like, I got to reprove the darkness. Y'all just going to hell. And they're just screaming at people and telling them how bad they are. And there's no anointing on that either. You look at the Scripture and you're just going out by your own ability and trying to do something. You want to wait on the Holy Ghost, what the Holy Ghost is doing. Amen. He said to follow him, not you. And you get out there and you feel all empty about what you're saying. And you don't feel that fire of the Holy Ghost burning up on the inside of you. You feel all empty about what you're saying. And that's because you're following you. You're trying to take the Word of God and you're trying to handle it for you. Scripture clearly says that they will take the Word of God and handle it deceitfully. And if we turn to all these scriptures that I am talking about and quoting about and bringing together, we'll be here for a long time. But it's very clear. If we're not walking in the Spirit, then Satan's wide open to come and to bring some kind of deception to try to allure us. Oh, thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy. He doesn't give up, though. He doesn't give up. And, you know, and I'm thinking, it makes me think about Romans. Let's look here in chapter 8. I'm just going to start in verse 31. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? And that's one thing we know. You know, when we come to Jesus, man, he is like about keeping us. That's his heart, and he's continually going over here, over here, over here, over here, over here. Just come love me, and I'll take care of you. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. He didn't do it for him, and he didn't have to do it for us, but he loved us so much. He loved every one of us so much that he did not want one of us to go to eternal hell. Do we realize the value of that? Do we realize the debt that he paid for us? Do we cherish that? When he is so good, why are we so bad to him? Why do we go hang out with his enemy that he knows, Father knows he will destroy us and bring us into death? That the purposes of all these things that he tries to package up and make look so interesting, the end thereof is death. Why would we participate with death when we can have life eternal? Now, not someday. It doesn't have to be hard where we can't bear it. Because when we have him, we can bear all things. When we come unto him, when we bring whatever thing that seems too hard for us to take and handle, when we bring it to him, he will walk us through it. Just like our little Summer, John's daughter, she contacted me last night and she said, I'm going through so much already. I'm going through so much already. She's, you know, I don't want to bring her business out, but it's a horrible situation that she's been in for the last couple of years. And she goes, I've just been fighting so hard to just keep my head above water. And she goes, and then my rock. God takes my rock. Why did he take my rock? Why did he take my daddy? My daddy was the one that was always there for me. He's the only man in my life. You know, why did he take him? And, you know, and I looked at it and I said, it's too much for her to bear. It's too much. And I said that to her. I said, Summer, it's too much to bear. But the Holy Ghost, he's our comforter. And I just shared with her, I'm like, you know, I wasn't in the state that she is in right now and what she's dealing with when my mother passed away. But my mother was the one I confided in. She's the one I prayed with. She's the one I called when, you know, something, I knew that she would stand with me in faith in God and she wouldn't go off about blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and so she's the one I ran to and called and talked to about whatever was going on, that she would stand with me and believe with me. And, you know, when she died, I felt like I was ready to wave her off to Jesus, because it was just that time that, you know, I prayed and prayed to get the breakthrough and to see her healed. But, it was that time for her to go, and so I waved her off. But I had no idea that I was going to feel like I had a gun blow through me and explode this huge gape in my belly because I sensed that presence of the anointing. This is the reason, you know, she was my mother, and there's that connection with the mother, you know, that lifeline of the navel cord, and she brought you into this world and that life there, and the same with the Father, and there's that connection, but the strongest connection is the power and the authority that she carried in this earth, the spiritual realm that she carried, because my mom, she was praying for people all the time. She was always praying. I knew I was prayed for every day, you know, and that's something I'll just interject here. I see people that don't have somebody praying for them, and I'm like, Lord, who doesn't have somebody praying for them? I want to be that one that prays for them. Because I know that my mom's prayers helped me and kept me, because she stood in the gap for me. And so after I waved her off and I'm like, Mama, tell Jesus I love him. You're going to see him face to face. Not like I can't tell him I love him. I don't know why I said that, but I was just so excited she was going to go meet him. But then suddenly she's gone, and that presence list from the earth and that authority she carried in God went with her. And I felt like there was a big hole blown through me. And I'm like, what is this? It was like somehow I was stunned and I didn't exactly know what was going on. It was just like I couldn't even explain. There was a loss there that I'm like, what is this? Because I'm used to walking over here in the presence of God. And I was like, what is this pain? See, a lot of people, they can't tell a whole lot of difference because they're so over in the realms of darkness. But I'm like, what is this? And, you know, finally I went home and I laid down in bed and I'm like, Lord, I can't take this. I can't take this empty feeling. I can't take this. And I said, Holy Spirit, you are our comforter. You're the one to send. You're the one that was sent to come and comfort us, to lead us and guide us into the presence of the Father. Now, Holy Spirit, I need you like I've never needed you before. Come and comfort me right now. And instantly, instantly. See, he's the supply we don't ask, though. He's the supply, but we don't ask. He's the supply, I said, but we don't ask. We look to us to fix it. When he is the supply and his fixing, I'm telling you, it works so much better than ours. Oh, hallelujah. He's the supply. Will you ask him? You receive not because you ask not. You got to go figure it out. And you waste years figuring it out when all the time, all you needed to do was ask for the supply and he would give it to you. Instantly, I felt that comfort. I felt filled up with the glory again. I felt the anointing. That big gaping hole that I felt like was on the inside of me was gone instantly. And I came to know the Holy Spirit in a way that I would have never come to know him unless I had gone in through that situation. And I found out how good it is to go through things like that. I'm not saying that I thought my mother's death was good, because God hates death. It's his last enemy, and he will put it under his feet. He hates it as much as we do. Precious in the eyes of the Lord are the death of his saints, but God has nothing to do with death. He hates it. He despises it. It is his enemy, and he doesn't have anything to do with death. But yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because I know you are with me. You are with me, your rod and your staff, they do comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy, and my cup it runs over, because surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in your house, O God, forever and ever. Oh, thank you, Jesus. But to come to know the Holy Spirit, I'm like, oh, it was worth it. And then I have comfort. And then I go back to my sisters the next day, and they're all allowing that evil thing of grief. Grief is darkness. Grief comes from hell. It doesn't come from heaven. Comfort comes from heaven. Just realize that if you'll take a hold of these principles in God and hang on to them, depression comes from hell. It does not come from heaven. The comfort of the Holy Ghost is there for any grief, for any depression, for any lie of the enemy, for any deception. The Holy Ghost is there to bring you right back over here into the presence of his glory. Hallelujah, Jesus. But I said, oh, to know the Holy Spirit like this, to come to a greater understanding. And I just felt like, okay, mama's gone, so I got to take up where she left off. And just grab a hold of another mantle, grab a hold of another purpose in God, grab a hold of something else in God instead of getting caught up in my grief. So my sisters are all caught up in the grief, and I'm like, no. The Holy Ghost is our comfort. Don't go there. Don't do that. But will you have ears to hear? They didn't. My one younger sister, she had a little bit of ears to hear. But mama was her mama. She never married. And mama, and she hovered over mama like, you know, at the last several years, like mama was the baby instead of the mama. And so she went from being the baby all those years to being the mama over mama. And I mean, like, she hovered over her. So it was very challenging. But still, the Holy Ghost will come and reveal himself in a way that you could have never experienced unless you went through that dark time, that hour. He's your comfort. Let him. Let God. Let God keep you. Let God work in you. Let God be the supply. Let God. Let God take care of the problem. Let God take care of the need. Trust him. Believe him. Don't murmur and complain. Because when you do, you're saying God's not enough. And you totally block the supply. You can give in the offering all day long. You can give your body to be burned. You can do all kinds of stuff of yourself. But unless you let God do it in you and through you, you'll just have you. And it's not very comforting. Hey, I don't like myself outside of the Holy Ghost. So if I don't like you outside of the Holy Ghost, don't take it personal. Just get in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Because really all anybody ever wants to hear about is what's going to be a strength to them to carry on. They don't want to hear about our ideas. They're like, ugh. And you leave going, you may not say it out loud and really have a conscious state of it, but you leave going, well, I have nothing else. I got nothing from that. That was boring. But when life comes forth, when life is spoken, when the things of heaven are spoken, you leave lifted up and strengthened and inspired. That's why forsake not the assembly of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but come together even the more. I don't know how people live without church. I got to be here all the time. And I agree with Pastor Mark. We need more. We need more. Because I'm like, I get here and I'm just like, the rain of heaven. You know, some people sit here and they squirm in their seats and they're like convicted and they're, and you know, people will come in and you can feel the presence of it. People, new people will come in and they're sitting there. Who is he? And what's it, what does he know? And what is she saying? And where's that? Wait, I didn't see them quote that scripture. Where's it at? And you know, oh God, help these people. And that, you know, and they're sitting there in their own self and they don't receive the rain of heaven. The rain of heaven is pouring out at your soul. The rain of heaven is filling everyone that's hungry. You simply just go, God, make me hungry. God, make me more hungry. God, make me more hungry. God, make me... I tell you what, when you get desperate before God and you start to cry out for him to make you hungry, first this divine dissatisfaction will come. And it will feel a little bit miserable and you'll go, what in the world's wrong with me? It's kind of letting you know that nothing you can do can satisfy you. You've got to run to his presence. You've got to run over here into the realms of his glory. You need him. So, I mean, I thought, you know, when I would first start to pray this, God, make me more hungry because I'm not hungry enough. I find myself too busy about this life and doing the things of this life that will lead you over into the world. Because you can do the things of this life in the Holy Ghost. I tell you what, if you could see me in my kitchen, I mean, that's me in Jesus' time. You know, the dishes are anointed, the cooking's anointed. The dance in the middle of the kitchen as I get lost in the realms of his glory while I'm cooking. You know, life is all about Jesus and his glory raining down. Hallelujah. My house is dedicated from one end to the other. My car is dedicated from one end to the other. I am the temple of the living God. He's come to dwell on the inside of me, and where I'm at, he is. And I'm not going to be happy unless he is. Anyway, I was over here in Romans chapter 8. Where was I? Oh, thank you, Jesus. He that spared not his own son. See, I get caught up in that. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. That's me. You can be left out if you want to, but that's me. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? That means everything you need. The supply of the Spirit, let the supply of the Spirit be all that you need. The supply of the Spirit. That's very simply, because I know people are like, how do I get the supply of the Spirit and go work my job? Being caught up in the realms of his glory. At your job. Saying, Father, what am I here for? What am I doing? Lord, what's going on here? Why am I here and what's your purpose? Who do you want me to speak to? What do you want to do? What glory do you want to show forth with where I'm at? We don't have to be under the load. We're on top of the load in the Spirit. If you're under the load, you've let go of the Holy Spirit being your supply. And you're struggling. And the enemy is going to be pulling on you over here. Come on, this fruit's good. Touch it. Taste it. Now disobedience. But thank you, Jesus. If we sin, we have an advocate, Father Jesus Christ the righteous. He doesn't want us to live in that. Because that's hypocrisy. And if you're committing sin again and again and again and doing that, just simply, I mean, the blood of Jesus, God's merciful. He's so good. But look, why live in hell when you can live in heaven? Because you're miserable over there. That's why you got all these movie stars and all these people that think that they've obtained, they've got, you know, they're set up and there's this, you know, pride, and you know, people are following them, and they have all this wealth, and they have everything, and they've bought everything there is to buy, and you know, they have it all. The richest people in San Diego, most of their kids before they were 30 died of overdose of drugs or committed suicide or something else. Isn't that right, Brad Wan? You know a lot of those kids that died. The wealthiest children that had what you would think had the most going for them. But they didn't have Jesus. And then the movie stars, and you hear of them overdosing on drugs and killing themselves and all kinds of stuff happening because they're empty. This world will never supply your needs. It will never make you happy. It will only do it for a moment. You'll get a nice wool sweater, and next year there'll be moth holes all in it. It's not supplying any of your needs, but for a moment. It's not eternal riches. Oh, why do we focus on those things when they're not eternal riches and we can have all the riches of heaven living in us? And he'll clothe us with cloth that doesn't get moth holes and things that do not rust, the eternal riches. That's what he tells us to do, to seek after those things that are in heaven where the moth does not corrupt and the thief doesn't break through and steal and rust doesn't take it over and leave it in a pile. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, wow, time's getting by. I haven't got into any of this. Anyway, I'm going to read this. Oh, Jesus, thank you, Father. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Don't allow the enemy to condemn you and beat you up and you know, make you feel lower than the dirt that you can't come to Jesus, because that's another deception. That's another deception. But to allow his condemnation to be on you. Oh, I made a mistake. I made a mistake. I made a mistake. And God's never going to forgive me. No, you're God's child. As long as you're not staying over there, as long as you come back to him, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you, and he's going to teach you. Just stay with the program. Just stay in church. Just stay right there where there's that perfecting of the saints, where there's the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher for the work of the ministry. That is what it's for. That is why the church is established, to bring us together. And so there's that in that unity and in that authority together, we can see the glory of God revealed in our nation and the nations of the earth. We want to see the glory of God revealed in our church. So we want to get past all of this other stuff that holds us back so we can focus in unity to see God's glory revealed and manifested in the place. Like's never been done before. Not a little bit here and there, but like's never happened before. Where the dead come in here and they can't stay dead because the glory of God is too powerful in the place and they got to get up out of the casket. The lame walk in the blind see. Hallelujah, Jesus. Not sometimes, but all the time. Because that needs to be our focus. But the enemy wants to keep distraction going on in the hearts and the lives of the people that will keep them out of this realm of glory. Can you think of anything better for you to do than to go and pray for people and their arm grow out, or their cross eyes go straight, or the blind eyes open, or the deaf hear? Can you think of anything more exciting than partaking of what God has given us to do? If we'll get a hold of this and get outside of ourselves and get over and completely into him, this is all we'll do. He'll take us there quickly. We see those miracles. I see miracles. I've prayed for many people and seen all kinds of miracles, but it's not enough. And I believe in the last day it's going to be like it was in the chapter in the book of Acts, where with one heart and one mind, they all spoke the same thing, and the glory of God was revealed so powerfully. The word of God was magnified. And they laid people in the streets just so the shadow of Peter could pass by. See, that was the unity of the church. It was everybody participating, because look at Stephen. He was an apostle. And he went doing great signs and wonders and miracles, right? Because he took a hold of what God told him. He was a man full of the Holy Ghost, just called to serve tables and showed forth the glory of God. And that is where God wants every one of us showing forth his glory. Everything that is not that is a distraction in your life to keep you over here busy and distracted I mean, Satan's good at it. Listen. Distracted from the purpose and the plan that God has for your life. No more distractions. No more distractions. Thank you, Father. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died. You didn't die for anybody, so keep your mouth shut condemning people. And don't listen to the devil's condemnations. You die for somebody, then you got something to say. Christ died for them, so love them like Jesus did. Amen? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. See, right there, man, that one, you know, when I'm going through things, that's another thing I grabbed a hold of. He, Jesus, is sitting right there at the right hand of the Father interceding for me. Jesus is right in heaven. How can we go wrong when we have that? When Jesus is going, oh, Father, in the name of Jesus, you see so-and-so. Father God, don't let them go over there. Keep them. Lord, like I prayed in John 17, keep them from the evil one. He already prayed for us to be kept from the evil one. So if we'll stay over here, he'll keep us. It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen, who is even at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. Who shall separate us from this love of Christ? Who shall separate us from this love of Christ? Who shall separate us from this love? Who shall separate us from this love of Christ? Shall tribulation? No. Shall distress? No, because we're caught up in the realms of his glory. Shall persecution? No. Famine? No. Nakedness? No. Peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. See, you look at it, the persecution that they came through, the church went through after Christ was taken up. There was great persecution. You know, it started in Jerusalem and then Rome and the things that they did, putting people in those arenas and killing them. But... And they even watched their children be killed before their eyes, torn apart by lions and everything else. They watched it, but they were caught up in the peace that passes all understanding, because their eternal purposes were more glorious than the earthly purposes, because they knew in whom they believed. They knew. They had taken a hold of that place in God, and they were not distracted from it. So then they were able to offer themselves up to God and allow their children to be offered up. Like I've told before, you know, I was telling Jacob about persecution, and you know, I was talking to him a little bit about ISIS and what they do. You know, they'll tell people to deny Christ and confess Allah, and if they don't, they kill them, and if they do, they kill them anyway. So I told Jacob one day, I said, Jacob, because Jacob, they love to hear, you know, they just like, what's another miracle, Nani? Tell us about another miracle. And what happened, Nani? And you know, tell us more. And so Jacob, and that's what they want to hear. It's amazing. We think they want to, you know, go have fun all the time. And they're just like, tell us about some more about Jesus. Because I remember that time you told us about this miracle. Tell us about it again, Nani. And so anyway, I was telling Jacob, I said, you know, Jacob, if I saw you and they were gonna kill you, if I didn't deny Jesus, you know what I would say, Jacob? I would say, Jacob, go to Jesus. Go to Jesus. Go to Jesus. Because I wouldn't deny his name. But my last words would be, go to Jesus. Because I know that this is only a moment. And I got to lead Jacob to Jesus with power and authority. Because what if I denied and they let him go? Then he would deny. And then eternity would be separated from God. So it would do no good. Anyway, if we realize we've lost our life and we're found in him, oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Our life is lost and we're found in him. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? I already read that. I'll move on. As it is written, I read that one. Nay, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him. We're more than conquerors through him. He is there enabling us to get through those things that are absolutely too hard for us to handle. You will go through things that are too much, too hard. You can't do them. It's too much. That's why he's here. That's why the Holy Ghost is sent, to lead us to Jesus, to bring all of that answer, to heal up all that wound, to be that comfort, hallelujah, and to lead us into all of heaven. It's good to go through too much sometimes so you can realize that you're not able to do it, that you've got to give it all to Jesus. You've got to give it all to him. For I'm persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Nothing can separate us from his love. Nothing, if we'll stay over here in the love. If we won't come over here and we won't look at it, then we'll never touch it and we'll never partake of it. So stay away from it. Love not the world. Come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord, and I'll receive you. See, and it starts with, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, it starts with, have no fellowship. I'm going to go there real quick. Chapter 6, and we'll go, all this chapter is just so powerful. All the Word of God is powerful. So we have to be limited to not stay here all day till 3:30 like we used to and run out and grab some dinner and come back. I actually miss those days. And if people aren't hungry for staying here till 3:30, well, you know, whatever. Let's move on. Be ye, in verse 14, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? Why are we messing with the darkness? And people, if you'll get that in every area of your life, the things that you listen to, the things that you partake of, the things that you watch, set no evil thing before your eye. If it's evil, do not set it before your eye. If you do, repent and turn from your evil ways. Because we could go in right from there. These things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. They will not and shall not. Unrepented sin will not get into heaven. If that's what you're living in, continually in a place of repentance, or you don't even realize it. You know, there's a lot of doctrine in churches today that believe that once you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it's done. You can live your life any way you want to. They haven't read the Word of God. We must give ourselves to the Word of God to know that we're living it out. And if we don't give ourselves to the Word of God, how can we know that we're living it out? We're listening to a few people preach. And we're partaking of what they've got to say. And they want to keep it over here all happy. So everybody stays happy. So everybody either gives their money to the offering basket or sends it to them in the mail. Because when people are convicted, they squirm. In Zinzendorf's meetings, the great, or no, I'm actually thinking of the guy that ran the Salvation Army, and I can't think of his name. As he would preach, what was his name? William Booth, yes. In his meetings, you know, they'd pray for the unsaved to come in. They would go out and they'd tell people and come to the meeting. And as they'd go out and tell people, they wore a rain jacket over their nice clothing under them. They covered with a hood because people would throw rotten tomatoes at them. And that's back when, you know, the potty was under the bed. And they would take the potty and dump it on them in the streets as they would go out and compel people to come to Jesus. And then they would come into William Booth's meetings. And, you know, the sinners would, the ones that were compelled to come, came in. And they would sit in the back and they would shred the songbooks under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. I'm like, oh, Father God, I want to take a hold of that. I want to take a hold of that place in you. But they would shred. He wrote a book, Help to Holiness. If you could look that up and download that, Help to Holiness. Boy, that book is powerful, written by William Booth. But they would just shred the songbooks because they were so under the convicting power of the Holy Ghost that they couldn't stand it as he preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. And one night he had these 15 men sitting in the back, and he made an altar call, and they weren't coming. And he was telling the elders and the people that worked with him on the front row, he's saying, pray now, pray now, pray now, pray now, because they weren't coming, they weren't coming, they weren't coming. He's like, pray now. And they're like, oh, we better get to praying because, you know, the old boy's upset now. And so they're praying, Lord Jesus, bring the convicting power of the Holy Ghost on these people. And he's like, they're sinners in the place and they're not coming. They were lifted, all 15 lifted up above the congregation and sat on the front row and then hit their face and confessed Jesus Christ because a man had power with God. Because a man had power with God. I want that. I want more. I want more of heaven. And look at that. He had that group around him that interceded together. See, one puts 1,000 flight, two puts 10,000. I'm always looking for somebody to pray with when I got something going on. I'm like, okay, I got to find somebody that's going to drop what they're doing and get over here in the realms of heaven and pull things back over here where it's supposed to be. Because there's more power in unity. There's power in unity, the unity of darkness. There's greater power in the unity of light. If we'll come together, if you'll come together as a family, you'll see everything broken off of your family, everything broken off of your children. If you'll come together, you got to minister to them and prepare them and bring them in, and then you come together in that unity, and you'll see the powers of darkness broken off of people. Read the Listen to Me, Satan book by Carlos Anacondia. There's a lot of authority that he has learned and can be imparted to you in that. There's power in that unity. Walk in unity. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I was over here. And what concord hath Christ with Baal? And what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. I'm the temple. What part do I have with anything that has anything to do with God's enemy? I'm his temple, and I want him walking in me. I don't want darkness walking in me. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord. And I will be, and be separate, says the Lord. And I will dwell in them and walk in them. Oh, I'm sorry. Be separate, says the Lord. And touch not the unclean thing. Touch not the unclean thing. Touch not the unclean thing. Don't eat of it. Don't eat of it. Don't eat of it. And I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and you shall be my children. Don't touch it. And we need to continually hear that until we take a hold of it and we're shining in the glory of God. Don't even come close to what's the world. If it's not of the Father, then it's of the world. If it's not from heaven, then it's of the world. Don't partake of it. This natural realm that we must live in, the existence of we need food and we need sleep, that's of the Father. He designed that. But he told us not to love it too much and not to get too caught up in desiring it because it would allure us away. We have to discipline ourselves in every area of our life. Paul says, I beat my body into submission. I tell my body what it's going to do. I take authority over this human body, and I tell it what it's going to do. It's going to get up from that pile of stones, even though it doesn't feel like getting up, because, I mean, that's painful. There was blood everywhere. It was painful to be stoned like that. You think a big stone's coming at you and hitting you in the head. And there were many that hit him all. They were around, they surrounded him, and he was left under a pile of stones. And he said, body, you get up in Jesus' name. I'm quickened by the Spirit in Jesus' name. I've not finished my course in Jesus' name. I'm going on to finish what God's called me to do. And he got up and he greeted the brethren and he went on to the next city. Walked. So you know he was divinely, I believe he was raised from the dead, but you know he was divinely healed and got up. Because they left him for dead under a pile of stones that big. That person had to be dead. Oh, thank you, Jesus. This is the power and the authority that we have to walk with God, not to allow the circumstances to take a hold of us. And now I want to ask, if there's anybody in this place that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, would you want to come to Him? Would you want to come to Him? Would you want to say, here I am? I don't know Him. I don't know that there's any person in this place, but I know that there's people in this place that you've tried to figure it out on your own. And you've done it on your own for so long that you almost don't know how to get outside of it because you continually find yourself doing it on your own. And Jesus says he's the supply to you this morning. He's the supply to you this morning. He is your supply. He's all sufficient for you. You need nothing else. So So if you'll just say, Holy Spirit, come and fill me. Father, in Jesus' name, forgive me and cleanse me from all of these things that I've held on to, from all these things that I've looked at and I've let them weigh me down. I surrender them now to you. If everybody would stand with me.